Bolts, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Sarah Hay, Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Judge Mike Williamson from the United States Bankruptcy Court down in Florida. And today's webinar is a very unique one. Judge Williamson actually has some people down in the room with him in Tampa, Florida, so he's doing a live presentation while also presenting this webinar. So we thank him so much for doing this for us today. But before we begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar within 3 business days on our YouTube channel. To access, simply go to YouTube and search Georgetown Alumni Career Services. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial in to the conference bridge number provided. You are not required to have a headset, but are welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us via the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area on the GoToWebinar control panel screen. We are hoping to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A portion at the end of the presentation, and afterwards I will email slides to everyone. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce Judge Mike Williamson. He was appointed to the United States Bankruptcy Court for the Middle District of Florida, Tampa Division, in 2000. He graduated from Duke University in 1973 and from Georgetown University Law Center in 1976. He began his bankruptcy practice serving as a Chapter 7 panel trustee in 1977. Thereafter, in the following 23 years, he represented numerous Chapter 11 corporate debtors, creditors committees, and trustees in bankruptcy cases pending throughout the state of Florida. Judge Williamson is the past chair of the Committee on Creditors' Rights, Section of Litigation, American Bar Association, past chair of the Business Law Section of the Florida Bar and that section's Bankruptcy/UCC Committee, and a fellow of the American College of Bankruptcy. So we are extremely delighted to have you here today, and Judge Williamson, I will now turn it over to you.
Thank you, Sarah. It's a pleasure to be back. I'm assuming no knowledge. We have some experienced bankruptcy lawyers probably on the line, and there are several in the room. This is not really directed toward those attorneys. This is directed to folks that seldom, if ever, get into bankruptcy court but want to know at least enough not to look like you've never get into bankruptcy court. That, by the way, is a very common appearance. We have somebody give a file to a young associate or a partner and send them over, and they don't know what to call things and they don't really know the basics. So I hope to give you enough so you can at least fake it when you come to court. And bankruptcy court is the most visited court in the federal system. We have an enormous number of cases, as the practitioners know. The Middle District of Florida is usually the second busiest caseload in the country. The Tampa Division average weighted caseload per judge is number 2 in the country behind Detroit. We're very busy. I have 10,000 active cases, which is a lot of cases even by bankruptcy standards. I'm going to discuss with you today a little bit of the history of bankruptcy, some of the basic terminology, where you find things, and not just for our court, but for courts across the country, where the sources, where you go to look, and then general concepts. First of all, the history of the bankruptcy laws. When I graduated from law school in 1976, we were studying the Bankruptcy Act of 1898, which was this very difficult law. I had a course by Professor Vukovic, and you were there at the time. I didn't understand a word he was saying. I think I got a lousy grade, and he would be shocked to know that I was doing this program and was a bankruptcy judge. In fact, many of my classmates would be shocked to know that I'm actually a judge now. But we did take the UCC, if you remember. We were the first class, those classes in the 70s. And because we graduated some of the first knowledgeable lawyers about the UCC. We became the bankruptcy lawyers in our firms. That's how it all started. During that decade, in the 70s, the bankruptcy professionals, the stakeholders, were all figuring out how to write a new code. And they had some of the best minds in the country come together and create the bankruptcy code, which was actually the Bankruptcy Reform Act of 1978, effective October 1 of 1979. That gave me a good opportunity to put all of my lack of knowledge behind me, because we had now had a new code, and it was sort of a fresh start for everybody in the profession. That became the law, and it was the jurisdiction given to bankruptcy judges under that law was incredibly expansive. In fact, so expansive and so much jurisdiction that it was unconstitutional. And so the Supreme Court in 1982 came out with the Marathon case, and you were around at the time, holding that the grant of really almost unlimited jurisdiction to an Article I court was not constitutional. And they basically declared our whole system to be unconstitutional. I remember Judge Pasquet, you know, thinking he was out of a job. To solve that problem on an interim basis till Congress could come up with a better solution, they came up with a model local rule. I used to joke around that we did by local rule what Congress couldn't do constitutionally by federal statute. And they created this concept of putting, actually under a local rule, of putting the jurisdiction in the district court and having the district courts refer everything to the bankruptcy court. That ended up being the model that was followed in the law that corrected the Marathon problem, at least attempted to, and that was under the Bankruptcy Amendments and Federal Judgeship Act of 1984. We called it BAFJA at the time. And that created the present system where the bankruptcy jurisdiction is put into the district court under Section 1334, and then under Section 28 U.S.C. Section 1334, and then under 28 U.S.C. Section 157A, the district court, if it so chooses, may refer those cases to the bankruptcy court. And of course, every district court, by general order of reference, very quickly thereafter, Terry Hodges entered ours here, which was the order until February 22nd of last year, when Ann Conway amended that for reasons I'll get to. And so we continued under this fiction that the district court would exercise the jurisdiction, but they referred to us, and we would make all these decisions. And if it was a core matter, it would be a final dispositive decision subject to appellate review. And if it was a non-core matter, that's a state court action, let's say the debtor was a contractor and had a lawsuit to recover money, that would be a non-core matter, that we would make report and recommendation to the district court, who would then basically treat it as what we didn't call a report and recommendation, it's called a proposed findings of fact, conclusions of law. But what the district judges would know is report and recommendations, that's the magistrate system. So we continued under that, and I'll say that until about a year ago, and practicing 35 years, I was never in a case where a bankruptcy court made a proposed findings of fact, conclusions of law to the district court for basically de novo review. It just, as a practical matter, everybody just sort of faked it and said, well, they may not have technical jurisdiction, but we're comfortable with it. And so we went on until the Stern v. Marshall case came out, and frankly hasn't changed much since then either, because now by new order of general reference, we still hear everything. We make the initial determination of whether we have the constitutional authority to do it. And if we're wrong, then the district court will say we were wrong and then just treat our findings as report and recommendation. And so the system still works and life goes on. There was one other major amendment to the bankruptcy laws that was in 2005. Those were the Bankruptcy Abuse Prevention and Consumer Protection Act of 2005. It was meant to make can-pay debtors pay. It was based on a perception that everybody was getting away with murder and bankruptcy. And frankly, for those of us that do this for the most part, probably a misperception, but that's fine. And they enacted the means test and various other things. It's driven up the cost, but everything goes on business as usual since then. As I've mentioned, our jurisdiction is found in Article 1, Section 8, which is the Bankruptcy Clause. We are a court created by Congress. We're an Article 1 court, and that's why we lack constitutional power to enter final dispositive judgments on state court matters, matters that would have been tried in the courts of Westminster in 1789, which is a passage out of Stern v. Marshall. After reference to us, we have sometimes have to determine core versus non-core. You hear a lot about that in these seminars. In practice, about 99% of what we do is core anyway, because it's really just part of the basic bankruptcy administration, and these issues just don't come up very often, except in adversary proceedings, which I'll get to. We can abstain, and often do, if there's something pending in district court or in the state courts. We have to abstain if it's basically ready for trial, it's a completely non-core matter, and we couldn't enter final decision in it, even though we have jurisdiction. You have to distinguish jurisdiction from this core versus non-core thing. The bankruptcy court has jurisdiction that the district court has by reference, and the district court has jurisdiction to consider anything that could conceivably be affected by the bankruptcy case. And that, so it's about as expansive. The bankruptcy jurisdiction in the district court is about the most powerful federal jurisdiction there is, because no matter what the cause of action is, if it has a conceivable effect on the bankruptcy case, the district court has jurisdiction. And the bankruptcy court, on referral, exercising that jurisdiction, has that jurisdiction. The question of whether we have a power to enter a final judgment is not subject matter jurisdiction. It's just whether we have the power to enter a final judgment. And why that's important? Because parties can consent to our making findings on matters that we technically don't have the authority, just like a magistrate trying a case by consent, although that's a little bit of an open issue. We also have cases removed to our court all the time from state court. And it's just like removing it to district court under diversity. If you have a conceivable effect on the bankruptcy case, any party can remove it. Comes over automatically, and then we decide, do we keep it or not. The sources of the bankruptcy code, where you go to look for it, well, obviously the bankruptcy code itself, which is when it was first written, it was a piece of beauty. There've been special interest groups that have been adding provisions now for years. We hate this because it just messes up a good law, but you know that's the process that we live in. But the bankruptcy code, case law, obviously the bankruptcy judges probably publish more cases than any federal judges, because we're a specialized court and we're encouraged to explain our rulings on very technical points of bankruptcy law in written decisions. Now, most of our rulings are findings of fact, conclusions of law under Rule 52 from the bench, and so when it goes up on appeal, that's more often not the record that will be. And hopefully, we have extensive findings from the bench, but we don't. We with the case that we have, we do not have time to enter written rulings, except you know. You prepare an order, and the order is typically for the reason stated orally in open court. We just don't. We hear everything just as a matter of survival. I just got off the bench for 3 hours, probably 50 lawyers in 50 different cases, and a lot of complex issues, and you just got to rule and keep moving because there's just too much of a volume. When we do publish a decision or write a memorandum opinion, it generally gets picked up by the West Bankruptcy Reporter. There's also bankruptcy court decisions. There's also the rules, we call the big rules, are the ones that are the official rules. They're counterpart to the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. So Federal Rules of Civil Procedure are incorporated by reference into the bankruptcy rules in Part 7, which deals with adversary proceedings. and they're also incorporated by reference in our bankruptcy rule 9014, which incorporates by reference some of the Part 7 rules. And the Part 7 rules, like 7012 of the bankruptcy rules, is Rule 12 of the Fed rules, except with the bankruptcy modifications to it. There's some things that we do differently in bankruptcy court. There's also treatises. Collier's is the most cited. I still use it when I have a general question or I'm writing an opinion and I want some general statement of the law. We also have, and these are the things to be aware of, be on the lookout for. Every court, not every court, every court's different, but most courts issue administrative orders that govern practice and procedure. They're going to be found on the websites. Look for those, and also the local rules, and which hopefully is where everything ends up ultimately. But there's administrative orders and there's local rules that govern procedures. Now, where do you find all that stuff? Well, I've got on the screen here what is our court's website. And every court in the country has a website. The nomenclature, if it's Texas, it'd be TX, Southern Bankruptcy with TXSB.uscourts.gov, and so you could figure out the rest of the states from that. But we're in FLMB.uscourts.gov, and you go onto that, and you'll see information and all of our stuff there, which I commend. If you're going to go into a bankruptcy court of a particular judge, please go to the court website and find out, you know, what are the local practices. I know I have, you know, practice tips, you know, the way I like people to conduct themselves in court. No one ever thinks of looking at this stuff, but it's very useful information. You can see I've just flashed the screen. This is our administrative orders page is on there. And then we have four divisions. We're the Middle District of Florida, of course, but within the Middle District, there's four divisions, and that's true in most jurisdictions. And they have their own administrative orders and practice and procedures. We also have a style guide that we did, and I commend it to, you know, lawyers from across the country, not just in practicing in our court. My law clerk started it and kind of took off. It's a, whether you're a bankruptcy practitioner or not, this style guide would be of great use to you. It's a place where we put all the blue book sites for the things that you need all the time. And it also has formatting suggestions on preparation of orders. It's really, really handy. And particularly if you're going to be practicing in our bankruptcy courts, but even any court, it'll give you one style to use, and you get all your employees and all your lawyers to use it. It's what we like to see. And it's just, you know, it's just good English. It tells you when to capitalize things and not when to put spaces between. And of course, I can tell you as a practice pointer on preparing papers for bankruptcy court, keep it short. That's, you know, the tendency, particularly the big firms, and the smarter the lawyer, the worse they are on this. They think a lot of pages is a point of pride. Young associates think they'll get shot unless they produce at least 47 pages, or whatever the page limitation is. We don't have, unfortunately, don't have a page limitation in bankruptcy court, so we get 47 pages. And I can tell you, as I'm preparing for my hearings, I'm coming in at 8 to prepare to 9:30 for a huge calendar. And I get ticked off when I get a 47-page brief because I'm thinking, what are they thinking? And I don't want 3 pages on the standards for motions to dismiss or motions for summary judgment. I want to know what relief you want. That'd be a very good first paragraph. And the reason, a little syllogistic paragraph, you know, statute of limitations, contract action is 5 years. This action was filed 5 years, 4 days afterwards. Therefore, this motion for summary judgment should be granted. I don't need to read anything else. That sort of approach, 3 pages. In my court, I kid around that I have a 3-3-3 rule. And those of you who practice in my court have heard it. Nothing needs more than 3 pages, no more than 3 cites for any point, and no more than 3 minutes to argue it. And then when I get a really big case with a lot of, you know, lawyers with the big briefcases, I say, we also have a 10-10-10 rule. I can explain that if you need. But it's just, and actually I do impose a 10-page limit on the big cases. And you know, it takes a lot of discipline to do something in 10 pages in a big case. But the lawyers get used to it, and it really produces some of the best writing that you can imagine, because they have to put down what's important. As a personal practice point, I think many judges would agree, I always like to know the date of the petition. Silly thing, but so much is driven by the date of the petition. So that's one fact you can, it's not extraneous. I've got here on the screen an example of a what we'd like to see in orders. That's in the style guide for those of you who are here. We also have our own web pages. Most judges do around the country. If you go to my web page, you'll see the phone numbers to reach my staff, chamber staff, and staff in the bankruptcy system is probably bigger than you would expect for the number of judges that we have. We have a small number of judges, and we have big staffs. And the reason for that is that's how we handle, you know, 10,000 cases or 7,000. It's I've got Mary Maddox, who's my my judicial assistant. She handles all the orders. Marty Malone, who's my courtroom deputy, does the scheduling and runs the court. I've got one full-time career clerk, law clerk, and one temporary one I share with judges May and McEwen. And I also have a supervisor who supervises my case managers, and they're not in chambers. They're located on the fifth floor. They technically work for our division manager. We also have on our website, we have Bankruptcy Basics, which is an award-winning primer on bankruptcy to show your clients, particularly consumer clients. It's really, really good. Judge McEwen put it together, and it got picked up by the AO, and it's now carried around the country. Now, let me discuss some nomenclature with you. In bankruptcy, if you know nothing about it, if y'all are bankruptcy lawyers or any bankruptcy lawyers, this is basic stuff, but I'm assuming not. Bankruptcy can be best viewed as a main case, which is the planet Jupiter, let's say, around which go planets. And planets are adversary proceedings and contested matters. So you have a case that gets filed, and it's the only thing it's referred to as the case is the Chapter 7, 11, 12, or 13. Around that circle proceedings. Now, there's general administrative matters that go on in the case. But proceedings are initiated by an adversary proceeding by Part 7. They're complaints. They're actually separate standalone lawsuits. We may have one case and literally 1,000 lawsuits going on, and that would typically be Ponzi scheme cases, which were the land of Ponzi schemes here in Florida. For you Floridians, you know why. Just we're fertile for fraud and taking advantage of the elderly and so forth. In those Ponzi scheme cases, we get hundreds if not thousands of adversary proceedings, lawsuits to claw back money that people made off the losses of the creditors. In addition to adversary proceedings, you have contested matters. Contested matters, how do you know whether you file it as a contested matter? Contested matter is a motion for relief from stay. You used to file a complaint for relief from stay prior to the rules going into effect, but now it's all done by motion. Most things we do are done by motion. How do you know it has to be an adversary proceeding? Look at 7001, it tells you. And we know certain things do. Complaint to determine dischargeability of debt, complaint to determine validity, priority, and extent of liens, you know, that sort of thing. Objections to exemptions and claims or contested matters, and all of those, we typically would schedule those for a preliminary hearing, a non-evidentiary hearing at which we determine whether it can be ruled on as a matter of law. In most bankruptcy courts, generally, be prepared to argue your motion when you show up, because we'll rule if we can. If there's contested matters of fact, then we're going to set them down for trial, and we move really fast. When you do have a contested matter going on, a motion for relief from stay, some of the rules that are incorporated by reference are all the discovery rules of Part 7, so you can take that position and do all the stuff that you're used to doing. Other general concepts. The petition date, I've already mentioned, is an important date. Why is that? It's also called the date of the order for relief. There is no order for relief, so you won't find it. It's a fiction, although it's very real in the sense that it is the order for relief that cleaves the estate, creates the property of the estate, which is another term of art. Property of the estate is everything the debtor has any interest in whatsoever on the date of the petition. If it's a Chapter 7, that's the cutoff from all pre-petition debts get caught in the 11, post-petitions aren't discharged and go out and sin again and you have to pay the penance. But pre-petition debts are caught. Pre-petition property gets caught, but not post. You can go out and earn money. Chapter 13 is a little bit more complicated in 11 because post-petition property becomes property of the estate, even earnings of an individual. The automatic stay you've all heard of course, even if you're not practitioners, it's automatic. There's no order. If you're told that there's a bankruptcy that's been filed, you're a creditor, that's all that they need to do is tell you, because now you're on notice. The burden is on you to go prove to yourself that it wasn't filed. You can't say, well, Judge, he told me he was, but this guy's been lying to me ever since I knew him, and I didn't believe him, and he didn't prove it. You know, the debtor doesn't have to prove it. If you do something in violation of the automatic stay, it's a violation of a injunction, and you can be sanctioned for that. And plus, any act taken in violation of the automatic stay is void under most circuit law and under the Borg-Werner case in the 11th Circuit. Exempt property is recognized. Bankruptcy defers to state law on exemption issues. So each bankruptcy court would look to state law, and in the state law you would have usually at the choice of going the, like I had a case today where Pennsylvania law applied, but it was either Pennsylvania or federal exemptions. The debtor could elect federal exemptions or state exemptions under Pennsylvania law. In Florida, we've opted out, our legislature has, so we can't use federal exemptions here, which is fine for us because Florida has pretty generous state exemptions, like the homestead exemption. The fresh start is another bankruptcy concept you hear a lot, and that's just that your discharge, your ability, that's the whole idea of moving on. And finally, distribution to claimants. The idea is that all that non-exempt property, if there is any, in most cases there isn't, comes in and gets distributed to the creditors. The bankruptcy code is made up of a number of chapters. There's chapters of general applicability, chapters 1, 3, and 5. They apply to all the other chapters. They're sort of the engine that runs the bankruptcy cases. The operating chapters are what you know. If someone says they file Chapter 7, it means they file a case under Chapter 7. Chapter 7 incorporates 1, 3, and 5. So if you're in a 7, then 1, 3, and 5, and 7 apply. If you're in an 11, 1, 3, 5, 11 apply, and so forth. Some more bankruptcy terminology. And some of this I'm repeating myself, but this is real important when you walk into bankruptcy court, or even when you're writing opinions or briefs, not to misuse this terminology. If you misuse it, it's okay, but it means to the reader that you're not a bankruptcy practitioner, and it brings into question. It's sort of like, you know, when you read something from the other side and they don't know Blue Book, all their citations are a mess. You question the scholarship. I do, and maybe I'm being a snob, but I mean, I like to see everything done according to Blue Book. I just spot the errors the minute I see them. And if it's all jumbled up, I immediately think, well, just this lawyer, you know, doesn't know the basics. And the same thing with this terminology. You come in the court and you call something a case when you meant proceeding a case. A case is the Chapter 7 case. This case was filed on this date. This proceeding, adversary proceeding, was filed. And that could also be a motion, but actually we usually refer to motions as matters, contested matters, adversary proceedings, and cases are different things. Petition, motion, or application, other terms that are used. There's only one petition in a bankruptcy case, and that's the paper that gets filed to start the case. That's a bankruptcy petition. You don't petition the court for anything. You move the court under, a motion is filed under 9013. You want an order, you file a motion, unless it falls under the small category of applications. And don't mix those up. Applications are filed when it has to do with retention issues, like an application to employ an attorney or an application to get paid. And it can be an application for administrative expense, in theory, or a motion for administrative expense. I've already mentioned adversary proceedings versus contested matters. And two other words just to keep separate is discharge versus dischargeability. Discharge is what you're looking for at the end of the day, forgiveness of your debts. And it's, I'll call it big D discharge. If you're denied your big D discharge, you don't get discharge of any of your debts. And why would that happen? Because you lied on your schedules or you're hiding assets. You're not playing by the rules, and you're not going to get a discharge. Then there's the term dischargeability. I call that little D dischargeability. That's the discharge of a particular debt. Let's say your debt was incurred through fraud. A debtor defrauded you. That is not a dischargeable debt, and so we use the term dischargeability. Contested matters I've mentioned already, but I'll go over again in summary. They're governed by Rule 9014. They're initiated by motion. Look at 9014 because it tells you what rules are incorporated by reference. You know, some of FRC, some of the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, which are incorporated in Part 7 of the bankruptcy rules, find themselves in 9014. You need to look at those. Like summary judgment is in there, and some aren't. For example, you don't file an answer. No response is required in bankruptcy court unless a local rule requires it or a court order. Service is very important in bankruptcy court, and it's one of the big mistakes that people make and that causes their pleadings not to be effective or are stricken. We're not checking service anymore because of budget cuts. We used to check service on everything. Now we're leaving it to the creditors to do, just like they do in other courts. If they don't serve you, you have a defense of lack of personal jurisdiction. The thing about bankruptcy service that is so dangerous is it's nationwide for venue and it's by mail. No sheriff or marshal is going to serve you. You're just going to get a letter in the mail with a motion doing something to you, and you can't ignore that, and because if you do, the relief will be entered, and that's valid service as long as it's first-class mail, postage prepaid. This quote the rule. It's Rule 7004. If you're filing a motion, let's say representing a debtor or wants some relief, make sure you look at 7004 because the service requirements vary depending on the type of entity you're serving. For example, if you're serving the United States of America, got to serve the civil process clerk and the attorney general, and you know, and then the head of the agency. That's like a student loan situation. We also do a lot of negative notice in bankruptcy court. That's by our local rules. Many courts do. That's because the bankruptcy code requires notice and hearing, and then it defines notice of hearing under section 102 to mean, you know, notice in such hearing is reasonable under the circumstances, meaning none. So we'll send out something with a legend on it that says you got 20 days to respond or the court may enter an order without, and we do tons of stuff by negative notice, so make sure you do respond. And the term for final evidentiary hearing, that's a trial in a contested matter. Adversary proceedings, I've already discussed to some extent, are basically similar to lawsuits in the district court. Part 7001 defines the scope. We do Rule 26 and basically most of it does apply. To be eligible for relief, to file for bankruptcy, that would be the next one there. Are you all doing that? Okay. 7 and 11, any person can file for bankruptcy. A person includes a corporation, any legal entity, and a person being individual or a legal entity. Chapter 13 is available for individual wage earners. It's used basically to save houses. There is the debt limits in 13 have to be less than $360,000. That's tied to inflation. and secured debts less than $1 million. And all individuals have to now get credit counseling, which has become very routine, and people do that on the internet. Okay, Chapter 7, the concept, conceptually, it's the idea is to get a fresh start. Non-exempt property goes into the trustee's account. The trustee has a 341 meeting, which is a meeting of creditors, interviews the debtor, finds out there's a car that the debtor maybe didn't list or that has equity in it. They'll usually work out a buyback, or they'll turn over the car. This morning, it was a Chapter 7 morning, although we have some other things mixed in, and I was dealing with turnover motions, objections to exemptions, and all that sort of stuff that happens in the routine sevens. Secured creditors retain their liens, and they would typically have the right to seek relief from stay and go after the car unless it was reaffirmed, and that's a voluntary process. And only unsecured creditors get paid in Chapter 7. Secured creditors don't get paid in Chapter 7. Unless their property is sold, of course, they would have a right to the proceeds from that if there was some equity in it, for example. In a Chapter 7, the trustee's duties are to conduct a 341 meeting. They collect the money of the estate, anything that's owed to the debtor or any money available. When you file your bankruptcy petition, the money in your bank account becomes property of the estate. The fact there are checks written against it doesn't change that. Remember that a check is just an order to your bank to pay someone on according to the check. And so that's debtors get caught on that all the time. Some banks now are freezing bank accounts when they get notice of a bankruptcy so that they don't get caught in a position of having let the debtor take money that was property of a trustee. And there's an issue whether that violates the automatic stay for the bank to freeze the account, and I think the better view and one that we follow is it's the prudent thing to do until the trustee can say okay. So get those bills paid before you file. The trustee will look at the exemptions and make sure they're proper. It will also avoid transfers. Transfer avoidance is done under chapters 545, which are statutory liens, 547, which are preferences, 548, which are fraudulent conveyances, and 549, which are post-petition transfers. The trustee then files an adversary proceeding, it's a lawsuit, and sues people. Typically, you see these preference cases. They also object to claims, and then they distribute. Fairly simple process, followed by every system in the world. Chapter 13 overview. In a Chapter 13, the debtor files a plan promptly within literally days of filing the petition. It's used primarily to reinstate defaulted mortgages. Let's say the debtor lost her job and she fell behind on her mortgage and was 6 months behind and a foreclosure starts. But there's equity in the house and the debtor wants to keep the house and has now got a job back. Well, this is a Chapter 13 case. They can file the Chapter 13. They have to immediately start making payments on the current payments through the trustee. Depending on your jurisdiction, payments are made through the trustee. And the debtor then proposes a plan to cure the arrearage over 36 to 60 months. So it's a way for them to reinstate everything, get it all back. You can't mess around with the first mortgage on a principal residence. It's the one exception to our ability to manipulate debt, if you will, in a bankruptcy. Is the first mortgage on a principal residence. And the reason for that is they wanted to preserve the mortgage market in America for principal residences. Although today there's some question about whether you can strip off a second mortgage on a property in a Chapter 13. Generally you can. Let's say the debtor files and has a defaulted first mortgage but has a line of credit. And this was all done about circa 2006, so the line of credit is way underwater. The first mortgage is probably underwater, so the debtor can reinstate the first and get it back, but the second is completely underwater because let's say the first mortgage is 250, the property's worth now 175, and then you got this other $50,000 line of credit. In a 13, that comes off because that's not a secured claim under bankruptcy law, and you can treat it, and what you do is you turn it into an unsecured claim. Sounds a little aggressive, but when you think about it, that's all it is. I mean, that lender will never see a dime on the collateral because the collateral value isn't there to support it. That's called a strip off. If in a 13, you can also do a strip down, and that's used typically for cars. Let's say you file a bankruptcy, and you may be current on your payments. The car is worth, let's say, $25,000, but you owed $30,000. So you could file a motion to determine the secured status of the lender, and usually they'll do it by agreement because there's not a, it's basically the NADA retail value of the car. And let's say that's $25,000, $30,000 owed. So how much is a secured claim? $25,000. It's not $30,000, that's just the debt. And so we strip down to the value of the claim. That's what happens in 13s. Reinstate that first mortgage, strip off the underwater second, strip down liens on personal property or even other realty, investment houses, things like that. And then that's the debt that is then treated under the plan. And what's that called? It's called a cram down, because you're taking, you're restructuring the debt. Bankruptcy judge then sets the interest rate and the terms of repayment. There's the leading Supreme Court case on that is TIL. We have what's called the TIL rate, which is prime plus two, which is just local lore, but most courts in the country are pretty comfortable with prime plus two. And that's okay, in a chapter 13, we have a lot of, we've standardized a lot of, as many courts in the country have, we've standardized a lot of our practices. Every court is different. Chapter 13 is a very local practice. Now, there is a move afoot on the National Big Rules Committee to standardize the Chapter 13 plan. We support that if they adopt our plan, because ours is the best, but unfortunately they're not doing that. Looks like they might adopt the Chicago plan, which we don't like. So we're going to talk about that. But we do have a standard form of plan. We require the debtors to file the standard form plan, and we just added a new paragraph to it that says that if you have to certify that no provisions that you put in your plan differ from the model plan. Now, why is, unless they're in paragraph 7, which is blank spaces, you got to put it. And why is that? Well, because a confirmation order, an order confirming a plan, has the same effect as a final judgment. It's a very powerful thing if it's not appealed. It's res judicata. And you can actually put something that's in what we call an illegal provision in a Chapter 13 plan, and it'll be binding because it's res judicata. I mean, because you had an opportunity to object and you didn't. For example, if you put on in your plan that confirmation of the plan will constitute a finding that the student loan you have imposes an undue hardship on you, well, that's an illegal provision because that requires an adversary proceeding. That's a 523. There's a procedure to discharge even a student loan. But it requires an adversary proceeding. But what if you put it in the plan and no one objects? There's a case called Espinosa. It's okay. So the bankruptcy, so in order to stop this illegal provision thing, we have adopted a standard plan where you've got to put all, anything unusual has got to be, you can't bury it in the text. And there was a lot of abuse going on about this for a while. And we now require them to certify right on the front page that there's nothing in this except the words from the standard plan. The debtor gets a delayed discharge in a Chapter 13 after making all the plan payments. A lot of cases don't make it. Some cases work out. They wanted to keep their house. By the way, we have a lot of mortgage modifications going on now in the Middle District of Florida. Judge Gentleman over in Orlando and Lori Weatherford, the Chapter 13 trustee, pioneered it. It's a wonderful program. It's working really well in Orlando. Starting to work pretty well over here. The big problem we're having, I think, is across the country, is finding the lender to talk to. You know, there's a surf, and I don't need to tell some of the lawyers here. You represent the lender, and you don't know on any given day who to talk to. We have, you know, we'll have the same bank show up in our court with two sets of lawyers, one representing them on the first and one representing them on this other, you know, on the real property, one representing them on the equipment, and or they both show up for the same one sometimes, or one represents where the servicer will come in. So it's a bit of a mess out there right now. And the other difficulty in mortgage modifications we're having is the lender quite appropriately requests a lot of documentation from the debtor. Debtor prepares it, sends it in, and then there's a new underwriter comes on, or time has now gone on, and so they want more documents. And so we keep asking. We come to confirmation hearing, and they say, "Well, we're still trying to mediate this thing." Having said all that, we're seeing a lot of improvement on the mediation side. Chapter 11 is what you would typically associate with the big corporate cases. It's unlike most systems in the world, this is one that we allow in this country to the debtor to remain in possession unless there's some fraud or really, really gross mismanagement. It's not mismanagement, it's real, real, real bad mismanagement, because every case is mismanaged, so they wouldn't be in Chapter 11, as I've told many creditor lawyers when they come in complaining about mismanagement pre-petition. They typically, I used to do debtor work and I did some creditor work and committee work. Chapter 11 work is a blast. It takes a lot of creativity. You're in there solving business problems. You're doing projections. It's sort of like a combination MBA, JD type of thing. You come in on the first day on what are called first day motions. This is a lot of cases get decided on day one. I can guarantee you that Lehman Brothers and General Motors that first week was the whole case, because they were working behind the scenes getting it ready, and sometimes they come in as prepackaged cases like General Motors. Lehman came in as a 7, for gosh sakes, and got sold within a week, all the assets, because time is critical in bankruptcy. Things have to happen very fast because in a 7, of course, because assets have legs, you know, they go out back doors if you don't get possession. But in an 11, things have to move really fast because the lender's collateral is being consumed in losses and things of that nature, and you have to come in and get controls on everything. You have to get the employees paid for some of their pre-petition debt, which is forbidden, but we allow it. Justified under what's called the doctrine of necessity, which is a bankruptcy concept that when we don't have any law to support it, we look to the doctrine of necessity. We just got to do it. You pay your employees. You have critical vendors who aren't going to supply you anymore, but you won't survive without them, and you got to pay them. You need to use the bank's cash collateral. Bank has a lien on the receivables, and they want to be protected, and so things will come in real quickly. The lender usually will come on board very fast. Good debtors lawyers will contact the bank the second they file and arrange to get together with their counsel to try to work something out for use of cash collateral. Also, in an operating case, a debtor in possession loan might be made. A committee would be formed usually about 30, 40 days down the road, not formed in most cases. The object, of course, is to come up with a plan. Typically, those get filed within 120 days. We fast track most of our cases here. We mentioned non-dischargeable debts in individuals, and this only applies to individuals. Corporations aren't subject to this non-dischargeability issue, but individuals are, and the principal ones are fraud, defalcation, willful malicious injury, spouses and babies, alimony, those sorts of things. They always get paid. Uncle Sam gets paid, and then there's some miscellaneous catch-alls. Objections to discharge. Remember, this is the big D discharge. If you made a fraudulent transfer within 1 year, this is one to watch out for. The wife is going into bankruptcy, and she gave her daughter the big diamond ring, you know, 2 months before bankruptcy. Don't file until a year and a day after that. You got to disclose it, and then it'll just be a fraudulent conveyance, which isn't going to. But if it's, more than 1 year fraudulent conveyance, and that's the worst that's going to happen there is the daughter's going to get sued and have to give it back. But you'll lose your discharge if you. You know, I had a big case one time. involving a debtor who gave his $500,000 boat to his five-year-old son within the 1 year. We were worried about that for a long time, but he had bigger problems. Concealment of estate property, failure to keep records. You can't come in and say, well, I don't know where everything went. False oaths, refusal to obey court order. Those could lead to denial of the discharge. The automatic stay I've already mentioned, it's self-executing. It's very powerful. It stops the race to the courthouse steps, and it's intended to provide a breathing spell. Relief from stay, if you're representing a lender, there's two grounds, cause or that's the bang head here is how lenders feel about relief from stay. If the property is not necessary to the reorganization and there's no equity in it, that would be a reason. And let's say it's totally over encumbered and they don't need it for reorganization, then you get relief from stay. Single asset real estate cases have special rules and people delaying, hindering, and defrauding their creditors would be cause for relief. Some deadlines to be aware of in the next slide there. The claims bar date, make sure you file a claim. There is an issue about it subjecting you to the bankruptcy court jurisdiction, but I would be more concerned about not having a claim. There's a deadline for objecting to exemptions, and it's a quick one. It's 30 days after the conclusion of the meeting of creditors. It's also a deadline for objections to discharge. These are serious deadlines, but while they may not be jurisdictional, they're enforced, and objections to dischargeability. There's a next slide, priority claims on distribution. Domestic support obligations come first, except for the trustees' work in producing money to pay those, come slightly ahead of DSOs. Otherwise, admin claims actually come after DSOs, which is new under the bankruptcy change in 2005. There's limited priority claims for wages, customer deposits, and taxes incurred within 3 years. Next line. Exemptions. Every state is different. In Florida, of course, we have virtually unlimited homestead, and personal property is rather limited. There's also wild card exemption. Next line. The means test, that was put in 2005, basically says that if you can pay, you file a Chapter 7, but you're making pretty good, you're making enough money to pay your creditors $11,725 over 60 months, you ought to be in Chapter 13 to pay your creditors. It's the idea is if you have enough to pay something meaningful to your creditors, you ought to be in Chapter 13. And so the U.S. trustee usually will bring a motion for dismissal under 707B, and they usually they'll go ahead and just convert. Okay, frequent filers now under the changes to the law. If one of the big problems we get is in repetitive filings, where people will file over and over to stop a foreclosure, they will come in and they file, they stop the foreclosure, they come in, they don't file any papers with the court, and then they get dismissed, and then the foreclosure gets set again, and they file a second time. I think this was one of the better changes in the changes in 2005. Is now you have to come into the court. If it's your second case dismissed within a year, you've got to get the stay extended. And the stay is only going to be in effect for 30 days unless you get it extended, and you have to move within the 30 days and actually get an order within the 30 days to extend the automatic stay. And you got to show some sort of change of circumstances where this case is different. If it's your third case, then there's no stay, and you got to get the stay imposed. And it's a high burden. You generally got to show something other than, this is just no reason, I just didn't do it. And it requires a court hearing. Let's see, next one. Proofs of claim. I mentioned there's a claims bar date. We now allow proofs of claim to be filed electronically, whatever your claims are on the date. The key thing is to attach documentation. Late claims, there is a standard. You could show excusable neglect in a Chapter 11. That's not true in 13 or 7. And then avoidance actions. Trustee has the strong arm powers. If you have an unperfected security interest holder, The trustee will file a lawsuit against that to declare that to be unperfected. Both under the UCC and under the bankruptcy code, the trustee stands in the shoes of a hypothetical lien creditor, and as we know under the UCC Article 9, a lien creditor that has a lien, actual lien on personal property trumps an unperfected security interest. Same is true in bankruptcy. Trustee basically then stands in the shoes of that secured creditor for the benefit of the estate. Other typical avoidance actions or preferences, fraud or conveyances, and any post-petition transfers made by the party. So that is, and then finally preferences. Those are transfers made within 90 days or 1 year within to an insider. There are some defenses to those. Ordinary course payments is the most common. Nothing wrong with taking a preference. My clients used to say, this guy's head into bankruptcy, wants to pay me, isn't that a preference? And I'll say, take it. And then you'll negotiate later with the trustee about paying it back. But it's always good to have the money. Fraudulent transfers, there's now a two-year look back under the federal law. It also can you incorporate whatever your state law is. We have the UFTA, Uniform Fraudulent Transfer Act in Florida, which is Chapter 726, and the trustee can stand in the shoes of any creditor that could have brought that action prior to bankruptcy. So if there's a creditor that exists, the trustee stands in the shoes and can look back 4 years under Florida law or 2 years under 548. It includes both actually in actual fraud or if it's not reasonably equivalent value insolvent. The more complicated cases there is when, let's say, a subsidiary gives a lien on its assets for a loan made to the parent. And you get into some, that's what the TUSA case was down in Fort Lauderdale, several hundred million dollars of liability. So structure of transactions, there's a whole industry out there that gives reasonably equivalent value opinions, and this can't be set aside as a fraudulent conveyance. You've got to watch out where the money's flowing from when you do deals. If a debtor's insolvent, be very, very careful dealing with them on any transaction. And I think that does conclude at least my part of it. And if there's any questions, Sarah, I'll be happy to respond.
Okay, great. Well, thank you so much. We do have a couple questions, but if anyone has anything else they'd like to ask right now, I encourage you to send it on in. But we did have someone on the line who was more on the business side of the house, and he was wondering if you could go over a few of the key concepts you mentioned. Stalking horse, process, timing. Are there any of those things? Or I know that we're running out of time, so maybe there's a resource you could point him towards.
Okay, a resource for what kind of information?
He was wondering if you could go over some of the key concepts that, you know, someone that was strictly working in business, not law, would need to know about. And he mentioned stalking horse process.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I didn't hear. Yeah, obviously that person is a business person that gets involved in large transactions. The stalking horse, when you, many 11s, if not most these days, chapter 11s are sales as going concerns or even sales assets, but a lot of, like General Motors was in essence a sale, but more typically the debtor will go out and let's say they've got a shopping center and they get together with the lender and the lender says, look, you need to sell this thing. Debtor says, I know it, but I need time. Give me 4 months to market it. I think I could sell it rather than have you do a foreclosure. So they will go out and they'll find a buyer, and that buyer will be the stalking horse. Now, why is he called a stalking horse? Well, it's from a Shakespeare play, but the idea is that no contract you enter into with a trustee or a debtor in possession is binding in bankruptcy court until the judge's gavel drops, and anybody can come in and say, I'll pay more. So what does that mean? That all contracts made in bankruptcy are subject to better and higher offers until the gavel falls. So the first lender, first deal guy or person or entity is the stalking horse, because they're out there and they're doing all the work and they're spending all the money in the due diligence, and they actually draw the asset purchase agreement and they become the stalking horse. Now, they get special treatment. We give them breakup fees and we require, you know, certain requirements for bidding and all that, and that's done in a bid procedures order. So that's a whole, I could speak for an hour on the sales out of bankruptcy, but that's what a stalking horse is. It's the first one to the party. They get some benefits, and if they have to walk away because they get outbid, they'll get all their expenses paid typically. There's usually some limit on it, but they'll get their expenses paid. Is there any other questions?
Yes, we did have one in the very beginning. If one moves to Florida, how long does one have to wait to file bankruptcy in that state and be able to avail oneself of Florida's homestead exemption?
I think it's 200. Let me see. It's in 522. B2. I haven't looked at that in a while, but it's. I can tell you where to look. It's. Any of the bankruptcy lawyers here know that? Do you know that? No. Okay. It's in 522, and it's for the where the debtor's domicile has been located for the 730 days immediately preceding, where the debtor's domicile has not been located in a single state for such 730, the place in which the domicile is located for 180 days preceding the 730 period. It's a complicated provision. Read it. It does make a difference. And then watch out for 522-ONP. And that's acquiring a homestead within a certain period of time. So I would study, it's 522B3A and 522, actually O, P, and Q, which deals with this homestead issue. And you can also, if you're found to have fraudulently diverted assets into a homestead before you file for bankruptcy, that can be set aside for up to 10 years. I had that come up today.
All right, and so we have one last question if you just have a couple more minutes. Could
sure.
You talk a little bit about Chapter 15 and how that would play out in a business with some U.S. operations?
Well, that's not a very easy one. After Chapter 15 was created by UNCITRAL, which is the UN commercial law group, to handle trans-border insolvencies, and it's countries that you can use it with countries that are party to that treaty under which it's adopted. We have adopted that law as Chapter 15. It just happens to fit into our chapter system as 15, and it is another. Now I've had a couple 15s. We don't get that many in Tampa, but the idea is if there is a case filed in London, for example, of a multinational, they can open up a case in my court, and then we can then be their court here to go after the American assets. And likewise, if we have a big 11 here, they can have a counterpart 15 over in Germany or any of the signatories to the Chapter 15 protocols. It's a whole specialty in itself, and I must say, as much as I would enjoy doing Chapter 15, we just don't have that many of them. That's generally what it is. Anything, any other questions there?
No, okay. Someone else, actually, that was just a comment. Another participant mentioned that another resource for Chapter 15 cases is globalinsolvency.com, a database of cases and links to the UNCITRAL working group. So in case that's helpful to anyone. But no, that is all, and I know we're out of time. So Judge Williamson, thank you so much for being here, and thank you to everyone who's in the room with you as well. And okay. To everyone else, we hope to see you on future webinars.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Appreciate all right, it. Bye.
Bye.